Nate.
Oh, Nate.
And I went to New York to continue doing Puerto Rico coverage. So anyway, yeah, but it's good to do that.
All right, so why don't we get started?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah, that is, okay. So we're sitting here with David Begnaud, right?
Did I Begnaud? Say, yeah, did you pronounce it? You pronounce it.
Awesome.
It's Begnaud. So
Begnaud.
It's that French name spelling. The AUD is an O.
Uh-huh.
So Begnaud.
Good. Well, we're sitting here with you.
Yep.
And now you're going to be the interviewee. I want you to talk to me about your experience. Why are you so connected to this situation? I mean, had you been to Puerto Rico before?
Never been to Puerto Rico. Okay. Didn't know many Puerto Ricans. Listen, the people here needed someone and still need someone to ask relentlessly the same questions. Why isn't it getting better? What more do you need? What is the problem along the way? There's nothing great about what I'm doing. You can do it. Anybody can do it. I think what happened is we just happened to resonate at a time when all connection had been cut off, and people on the mainland were able to start watching some of our work, and it became a lifeline for them. And what it has taught me, it's actually given me a reverence for journalism that I didn't have, and I think you can't have until you cover a story like this. Again, as you can tell, I get a little uncomfortable when people sort of celebrate what we've done, because...
Well, it's not so much celebrating.
Yeah,
I think it's acknowledging.
Sure.
Because I'm a journalist.
Sure.
You know, I'm a journalist too, and I know what you're talking about.
Yep.
I mean, I've covered emergencies and other sorts of situations where you're obviously not the news. You know, we're there to report it and not be it. But certainly there's an acknowledgement that comes for your work, especially from the diaspora in the States. I think the following that you've gathered, just because at some point you were the only person that they were able to watch. I mean, we were cut off from the world. I didn't even know what was happening for like 4 days. I had no idea how bad it was.
You know, thank you, first of all, for the acknowledgement. It means a lot. But again, I hate for any kind of focus to be on me.
Mm-hmm.
But if that focus you're talking about also shines a big light on what is an injustice, then so be it.
Sure.
Because the injustice that's happening right now is that 23 days after a storm made landfall, nobody seems to be able to figure out how the hell to get enough good drinking water to the people who need it. That's an injustice.
Absolutely.
Okay? And so,
how long are you going to be here?
I don't know.
It's indefinite now?
Well, you know, listen, I need to go home and pick up some clothes.
Okay.
I need to go home.
Where's home?
I live in Dallas, Texas.
Okay.
That's where I'm based.
Okay.
I need a haircut. I need one night of 8 hours of sleep. But you can't give up on Puerto Rico, and we won't, right? Especially since, and I said this in the very beginning, and you know this from being here, this is an endless emergency.
Absolutely.
And I have covered national disasters for the better part of 15 years, and I have never in my career covered a disaster where the emergency was unending.
Right.
Never, never. And, you know, I was interviewing your Secretary of State recently.
I saw that.
Very nice gentleman. Mm-hmm. And he said to me, we're in the recovery phase. And I said, sir, there's no recovery that's happening right now. And I don't know, I don't think it's fair to call it a recovery while there's still an emergency going on, right? I mean, what is it today? It's today's
13th.
The 13th of October.
23 days.
They had 13% of the island with power today, and now it's down to 9.
Right.
There was a power station that lost power.
Right.
So where power has been restored, they're losing it.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's an ongoing story that CBS News... We have no plans to stop, right?
Okay.
You have to rotate crews out.
Mm-hmm.
You have to charge your battery,
yeah,
so to speak.
Now.
Yeah, and so that's where I meant crews that can be. Remember, I'm not doing this solo.
No, I know.
Right, I'm buoyed by an amazing crew of some of the most talented journalists that I've ever worked with that have made it possible for us to get on television, right? Mm-hmm. Remember, it's hard to tell a story if you don't have the capability to broadcast.
Sure.
And I've had some remarkable people who, when nobody else could get a signal,
they were
able to get us a signal to tell the world what was going on. And I don't know if you feel this way. I know you're doing the interview, but I'll ask you. Have you ever experienced journalism being a lifeline like it is here?
No. This is what's keeping us in the spotlight, for better or for worse.
Well, and I'm not so much talking about that. I mean, listen,
but yes.
You know, the president calls it fake news. Listen, people have been bagging on journalism since
forever.
Day one, sure. Hundreds and hundreds of years ago, right?
I mean, we're always the bad guy.
It's par for the course, right? We're used to it. But I went back to the mainland to pick up clothes with a reverence for journalism and a respect like I have never had before. And guess what? It came from the people. You know how social media can be cruel. I've never seen one story unite everyone in a similar way.
Right.
I mean, I don't read the comments about how much, you know, people think we're doing great stuff. Because if you buy into that, you have to buy into the haters too, right? So I just kind of keep a balanced tone about it. But I've noticed that everyone has spoken to how much journalism has done here. Not David Begnaud, but how much journalism in general has meant.
Because I think we're keeping it real. While other people are saying that everything is coming back to normal, it's so not.
Absolutely.
And it's so far from it.
But to suggest that it's coming back to normal
absolutely
is laughable.
Not.
I mean, I interviewed a cancer patient, stage 4, in the hospital last night, trying to get to the mainland. And he's in the hospital, and the air goes out. The power goes out. The Cancer Society brought him a fan with batteries because he's not even guaranteed consistent air conditioning.
The problem is that we were so not prepared for a category 4 or 5 or whatever you want to classify.
And those will be good questions to ask your governor when the time is right. You know, he's in the middle of trying to figure out an emergency, and I believe he has the best intentions. But I believe he doesn't have everything he needs to do what he wants. And does he bear some of that responsibility? Is some of this his fault? That's not for me to answer. That's for people to decide.
Sure.
But the questions are legitimate in saying, what was your game plan? I remember being here, and the governor said to me, we were walking through a neighborhood a couple days before the storm. He said, this has the potential to be a catastrophe. He predicted, right? Called it. Clearly someone was giving him that expert information. So what was done ahead of time? Now, we all know that Puerto Rico was in dire straits to begin with, right? It was kind of like that bicycle that's lost all its wheels but one, and it collapsed.
But you know, the other thing is that we spent the better part of the last 20 years.
Yep.
We were in some sort of a bubble where all of the storms that were coming veered either to the north or to the south, and we were spared.
Yep.
So we got used to, you know, the thing about, that's not coming this way.
It's all good.
It's okay.
And you know what? Listen, disaster fatigue affects everyone, okay? It's not just Puerto Rico. I mean, so I covered Harvey, Irma, Maria, and I just covered Nate in Mobile, right? Everyone, and I grew up on the Gulf Coast, I'm used to people saying, yeah, whatever, it's not going to be that bad, right? And I think a lot of people had that thought here.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
It was a game changer. This hurricane has been, and you may have seen this video as well, Lieutenant General Russell Honoré, the retired general of the U.S. Army, told me last night, this is 10 times worse than Katrina. And I thought I misheard him, and I said, did I misunderstand you? And he said, 10 times worse.
Yeah.
He said, it's a crying, damn crying shame. What's happening here in terms of the federal response?
Our history is going to be marked before and after Maria.
Before Maria and after Maria.
You know, I have never seen anything like this, and I've, you know, been through a couple of hurricanes.
Sure.
But the truth is that, like you said, there's so much more to be done. I think the U.S. has a greater responsibility than it is exercising right now. I don't know about you, but the president's visit was a slap in the face for many people.
I've heard that. And it was my job to show what happened when the president was here, not to opine about what I thought about
it.
And I will tell you, you know, I've been intentional this entire time to simply report what we've seen.
Mm-hmm.
And
which
what
is your
we've
job.
Seen is nobody talking about Donald Trump. The
okay.
only time I saw people talking about Donald Trump was the day he was here.
Okay.
And mainly because we went out and asked folks, what do you think about the president's visit? What do you think about what the president said? Not one person, unsolicited, has mentioned Donald Trump's name to me.
Wow.
Other than the mayor of Aguadilla, who said, Mr. Trump, you know, I hope you come here to Aguadilla.
Mm-hmm.
No one. The
That's
good people of Puerto Rico have said the same thing. Man, woman, old, young, doesn't matter. Rural, urban, where are the supplies? Why are they not getting out faster? I talked to a DEA agent today who told me something very interesting. They were in Añasco.
Mm-hmm.
They've been using helicopters. They've seen people on their rooftop. They've seen people mm-hmm. stranded because roads have been cut off. And he said to me, we're experiencing people who are in need, but have actually gotten accustomed to having things delivered to them and are not going out in search of finding it. And that's not to say anything bad about those people, but it's just to say in disasters, a lot of times you have to throw out all the rule books
mm-hmm.
and understand that there are people in need and maybe they couldn't find the municipality. So when you started servicing them, they thought more help is coming
mm-hmm.
rather than you've got to go get the help at the local government,
mm-hmm.
right? And a lot of confusion for people has been, how exactly do supplies get out?
Yeah.
Right? And the way it works is that FEMA supplies the island with what they need. The National Guard distributes it to the local governments,
mm-hmm.
and it's the local leaders
mm-hmm.
who've been given the responsibility to disseminate. Okay, that's a three-step process. If anybody isn't up to their game, there's a lag, right? I remember talking to the Ponce police officer who said to me something staggering. On one shift with 38 police officers, they had only 19 bottles of water. It was a half bottle per officer. He said this to me in uniform. And I said, are you concerned talking to me? You might lose your job. And he said, I'm concerned, but I'm more concerned about what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Now let me ask you, you don't speak Spanish.
I don't.
How have you been getting around?
I've had some wonderful interpreters.
Have you?
Wonderful interpreters.
Okay.
And my experience has been most people can, they might understand what I'm saying, but they can't respond in English. We've made it work.
Mm-hmm.
What I've learned is that you don't have to speak the same language to communicate the same
mm-hmm.
message.
Mm-hmm.
And the same message is, we are desperate. We are desperate. Right? We are desperate. And, you know, oftentimes people will say, my country, my country. And I think that confuses some folks because they think of it as their country, like their island, their everything. But they're American citizens.
Right.
And they have every right to leave tomorrow and go set up shop in Miami.
But that's always been part of our identity crisis.
Right. Let me ask you this. And again, I know it's your identity. Do you think that in any way is hurting the situation?
I think so.
How so?
And I think not only that, but also, you know, from reading the social media comments, because I read them.
You do?
I do.
Oh, okay.
I do. Because I get a sense of what the thought process is up in the States.
Yeah, that's fair.
And
by the way, the social media, I get literally almost 1,000, more than 1,000 messages a day. They've actually been very helpful.
Well,
from
good.
A lot of people who have sent tips, or can you check this out, can you check...
But there's a lot of discrimination against Puerto Rico coming from up there.
How
many
so?
People.
How so?
Because the thing is that we've always been thought of as second-class citizens.
Right. People have told me that. Yeah.
The second-class citizens.
People have told me that.
And that's something that comes from ignorance. I've always told people, you know what, pick up a book so that you can see that we are part of the United States. We may have an ocean dividing us, but we are part of the United States. And just because we speak Spanish doesn't mean that, you know, we're not as much of, you know, as much as an American as a North American.
Sure.
Because America is very big.
Right.
It's not just North America. Not just the United States. But the problem is that there's a lot of ignorance. And that trickles over to racism. you know, when I was growing up in Connecticut, it was pretty tough.
Is that right?
Sure.
Really?
Yeah, because the joke was that I was too white to be Puerto Rican, and I was too Puerto Rican to be white, so all my friends were black. Mm. You know? Mm. It's one of those things. Because we don't have a cookie cutter mold. We don't look all the same. We all, you know, you have dark skin and you have white skin. But I think that this situation has brought that forward so much so than anything else. And the thing about the identity crisis, people here call Puerto Rico a country, but we're not. Legally speaking, we're not. And maybe if we were a country, we wouldn't be in this mess.
Right.
Because right now, even the Jones Act thing is a situation. We can't get supplies from ships that aren't under the U.S. flag. That 10-day hiatus wasn't long enough at all. We only got one ship in from Germany in 10 days. So, you know, the situation that we have here is very specific. And with this storm, it's just been brought to the limelight, you know, how much people need to learn about who we are and why we, you know, deserve the FEMA help, just like Texas and Florida and Louisiana and whatever, and how much we need, you know, all of that. The comment about, you know, these people can't be here forever was just, you know, insane, because forever is 3 weeks. It's only been 3 weeks. And like you said, compared day 23 to day one, and it's
for many people, it's the same. For many people, it's the same.
You know, but I think that what you're doing, you know, not sitting behind a desk, going out there every day, certainly helps, you know, to deliver the message that American citizens are suffering.
It's our job to keep it front and center.
Sure. The thing is that other headlines come up and
Well, and to your point, Lieutenant General Honore said to me, thank you to the president for putting Puerto Rico back front and center by making that comment. You may not have liked the president's comment, but the general believed it thrusted Puerto Rico back onto the front page. But at any rate...
So how long will you be here? You don't know.
I don't know. Again, I gotta
go home
and get some stuff.
Get some sleep.
But don't be surprised if I'm back real quick.
Yeah. Want to tell the people, you know, anything in particular about what this has meant to you?
Look, it's been humbling. It's been maturing. It's been, I think, probably the most important story of my career. And it's also been a reminder that more often than not, people are wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
And even in the most desperate times, the best of people shines through.
Mm-hmm.
And Puerto Ricans are some of, and I've said before, the most resilient and the most patient people I've met.
Mm-hmm.
And they deserve better than what they're getting.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.